and Backstraps, brought to you by Homes by Shayne and produced by Danny Geo Productions.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is the Boots and Backstraps Podcast.
Come on now.
Honey's on, looking for backstraps, way deep in the woods, tracking in a swamp to a hay field under the harvest moon. When the tags are filled, it's time to switch up our boots. Head down to the honky-tonk, get us a swing dance or two. We're talking about boots and backstraps.
Hey everybody, this is a show where we talk all things hunting and country music.
From the classics through today.
From big bucks to bull elk. We've got it all.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to another episode of Boots and Backstraps. I'm your host, Shane Michael, and I'm joined in studio by my soon-to-be standing on a WeFest stage co-host, Mr. Tom Katt.
Come on now.
Yeah, I love the jersey, brother.
Yeah, I was going through my closet. What should I wear tonight? And I saw this old WeFest jersey that one of our guests made for me, Michael Jordan. And he owns Unreal. And my wife and I were asked to throw out the first pitch at a Twins game a few years back. And I thought, well, what should I wear out there, you know? Being fashion conscious. And anyway, thought maybe a WeFest jersey. It was a WeFest promotion at the Twins game. And Heidi from Hitchville and her partner, they were singing the national anthem.
Heidi and Matt.
Heidi and Matt.
Yeah.
And so it was a real fun deal.
I think when she was here, we played the video, right?
I think we did.
Yeah, we found it on YouTube.
Never heard anyone sing the national anthem as sweet as Heidi and Matt did.
Yeah, it was awesome.
Yeah, it was unbelievable.
Well, you definitely have some taste there, partner, because you know, all the years in watching you on the stages that you've been on, you have always taken great pride in making sure that you're getting Westerned, and I know it's yeah, appreciated by the fan base for sure.
Yeah, I don't know. Just kind of ran in our family. Want to dress it up a little bit. You know, as the WeFest progressed over the years, the entertainers, you know, back in the day, back in the 80s and the 90s, they'd wear some pretty cool outfits.
Yeah.
And then that tapered off, and then they just... I remember Vince Kill coming on after playing 36 holes of golf. He just had some coveralls on and a T-shirt. But, you know, a lot of times they just come out in T-shirts. And that's the way it is nowadays. And I have,
yeah.
But I always like to dress it up a little. I thought, if we're going to be the number one country music event in the world, which
yes,
we were
yes,
for almost 30 years.
And will be again.
And will be again. Why not dress it up and be professional, you know?
Amen to that, brother.
Yeah, that's what I always thought.
Well, let's get into our first segment of the show.
Yeah, I'm excited.
As always, it's our whiskey of the week.
I cheated.
I think the fans come to expect that now, or you're going to get into the bottle before anything else. I almost have to hide it from you. Thank you, Jill.
This is exceptional bourbon.
It is exceptional bourbon.
And this is your deal, and I'm going to let you run with it.
Yeah.
But I wanted to throw that out there.
No, I'm
here's to you.
A little clink and drink here, and then we'll get a clink and drink from the guests, too. Thank you, sir.
There it is. Fire away, Shane. Tell them all about this.
Wilderness Trail. So Wilderness Trail is a Kentucky bourbon. And the big thing with Wilderness Trail is it's very new in sort of the world of bourbon or whiskey distilleries. They were founded in 2006.
Okay.
By a couple of guys that played in a rock band together. They were musicians.
Yeah.
And one of the gentlemen, that's one of the co-founders, his family had been in whiskey distillation. That's the right word, right?
I think you got it.
Whiskey distillation for several generations and owned a distillery making whiskey. And so then this guy and his buddy that were in the band together said, hey, you know, this music thing, it probably isn't forever. You kind of get to the point where,
yeah,
you know, you can't be standing.
Whiskey's forever.
Unless you're Charlie Daniels, you're not going to be standing on a stage at 90 or whatever, and, you know, whatever he made it to.
What was the band of any note?
No one that I'm familiar with, which doesn't mean anything because I don't know a lot about rock. But
okay,
anyway, so they start this distillery, and they decided they were going to be competitive in the market, do some unique things. They've got a patented way that they heat the mash, and it's something that, like I said, that's unique to them. And then they also were the very first distillery of anybody making whiskey or bourbon to use a chemical-free steam boiler.
Hmm.
And so now that chemical-free steam boiling process has gotten really big with a lot of the distillers where they've switched to that because these guys sort of pioneered that. But that's Wilderness Trail.
That's cool. It's really smooth, really smooth.
It is indeed.
And this is a fun segment. You know, Shayne and I are not advocates. Maybe at one time we were advocates of drinking a lot, but, you know, it's like drinking wine or anything of high caliber. It's, you know, it's great sipping whiskey, and we don't encourage you to chug a bottle of this.
We're going to be here a couple hours.
Yeah, we're going to be here a couple hours, so we're going to enjoy some absolutely phenomenal bourbon. And Kenny Chesney's with us here tonight.
Not so much.
We already started. you got to break the ice on that one.
So we are, as we always say, we're super excited about tonight's episode.
Absolutely.
And me especially, because I've known our guest for, I mean, it seems like 20 years. It's the first time I saw him perform on stage.
You know, we've had a lot of guests on recently that were old friends of yours.
Yeah.
I guess if we had any of my old country friends, they're probably gone and dead by now.
Well, we just moved the chair over, make room for the wheelchair, and then you just roll right up here.
I mean, I'm thinking of people like, and there I go again, can't remember the name, but he's been around forever. He does the Johnny Cash thing. And
you have a name assistant
tonight.
Sherwin
Linton.
Sherwin Linton, thank you.
See, there we go.
Sherwin Linton, and I mean, the original High Noon, and guys like Daisy Dillman, and, you know, I go back to that era. But obviously, I've worked with a lot of people up until the 2000s.
Yeah.
So I do know a lot of them, but the people you're bringing on are kind of newer than as far as I go back.
I'm sure that you've met our guests tonight at some point back in the day with as much as they had in fame. So without further ado, we will bring into our studio for the Boots and Backstraps podcast this week of High Noon and several other projects, but most probably notably in this market for High Noon, Steve Kretsinger.
Ooh, jazz hands. Oh, I like that.
Oh, I was like, where's the... He's got a brand new button bar. Like, where's the sound effect?
Boy, she was late on that deal.
Yeah, she's busy.
First time.
Yeah, but when you got it, it was awesome.
It was. Well, welcome, Steve.
Thank you for having me. I very much appreciate it.
Yeah.
We're excited to have you in with us. Did you get your little infographic with your name and stuff?
Yeah, I like that.
Isn't she good?
It's totally cool. Yeah.
So I know you've had a lot going on lately with solo stuff and all that kind of thing, but what I like to do is maybe just get in the way back machine and kind of go back to where it all started. Like, where did music come into your life, maybe some of your early influences, all that stuff that started your love and passion?
Well, you know, it started out when I was too young to remember, to tell you the truth. My grandma used to tell me that I used to sing Raindrops Keep Falling on My Head when I was a very, very little kid. So, you know, that was, and that, you know, I was born in 1972, so that song came out probably 74-ish, you know. So it was very, very early in my life, and I couldn't really speak the words properly, so I would sing what I thought the words were.
I'm sure it was adorable.
But it probably was pretty cool. But when I could start to remember things, again, when I was still pretty young, probably 75, 76, maybe even a little bit later than that, I'm not sure when the song came out, but We Will Rock You by Queen came out, and We Are the Champions, you know, that pair of songs.
Yeah.
And I remember my brother, Corey, my oldest brother, Corey, who's also a very good vocalist, used to sing all the time. I used to sing with him when I was a little kid, but I picked up a pair of drumsticks, and that was the first time I can remember I did the boom, boom, ba, boom, boom, ba, and I was playing along with it perfectly, you know. And I actually was a drummer. Here, there's a picture of me when I was 13. That was my first drum kit, the first day I ever had a drum kit of my own. My brothers actually bought those for me. And my parents did not know that they were going to do that for my 13th birthday. So
how happy were they?
Well, my mom, I don't know that she was all that happy, but my dad actually used to, I would sit upstairs and play for hours. I mean, I was always obsessed with it. So I'd sit up and play for hours, and I had these.
So they're looking at you like, we're so happy. You know, your brother's like, you're grounded.
Exactly. Well, my brothers were too old to be grounded at that point. But I had these, like, trash can lid cymbals. They were all bent up. They looked like old warped records. You know, they're terrible sounding. But my dad used to sit down in his chair, and eventually, you know, he'd get tired of me playing, and he'd be like, okay, enough's enough, you know. And I'd come downstairs, and he'd still be kind of tapping on the chair. So I think my dad actually liked it, even though I don't think he was going to tell me that he actually did, you know. But Got started being a drummer. Like I said, I played for a long time, up till about the time I was a senior in high school. And I realized, probably when I was a junior, I borrowed a friend's guitar, and I
were you playing like bands or what were you?
I was doing drums in bands. I played with my oldest brother Corey's band when I was 14, 15, 16 years old in bars.
Oh, cool!
In Forest Lake. What the heck is it called? Martin's Resort, which is way up north someplace. I mean, I filled in because the drummer that they had at that time, they had issues with.
Ah, yes.
So that they would fire him all the time and rehire him. But in the meantime, I would be the fill-in guy. So I took to it pretty quick. I would not say that I was a super great drummer, but I was good enough to get by and get the songs done, get the shows done. And I made a little bit of money doing it. So it was nice, but... You know, about 11th grade, I picked up a guitar, borrowed a guitar. I was listening at that time to, I had hair, man. I had long hair, and it was long in the front, and it was long in the back, and I was like metal on the drums.
Yeah.
I picked up a guitar, and it was Jim Croce. And I absolutely loved Jim Croce.
Holy polar opposite.
So I sat on the couch, and I started becoming obsessed with it, and it was electric guitar, so it didn't make any noise. So
the Time in a Bottle, is that what it was?
That was it was the first song I wanted to learn, because I said, if I could ever learn Time in a Bottle, that would be as good as my guitar.
Not Dust on the Bottle.
Well, I do that one too. But
yeah,
but no, Time in a Bottle was the first song I wanted to learn. I thought, if I could just learn Time in a Bottle, that would be as good as it could ever get for me. That would be the pinnacle, the height of my guitar playing. And then it turned into, you know...
How many chords is that? That's three, isn't it?
Oh, there's a lot of chords in
really?
That song. Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, it's a difficult song, and there's a lot of movement, but... You know, I learned it. Don't know that I ever mastered it, but I learned it. I still play it today at my solo shows. And then it just moved on from there to other Jim Croce songs. I was obsessed. I mean, literally obsessed with Jim Croce when I was in high school, which wasn't cool. Jim Croce wasn't cool, okay? It was Guns N' Roses, and it was Poison. And I love those bands,
well, the 80s,
too.
Right?
Yeah.
The hair bands?
It was the end of the 80s. So you were talking 86, 87, 88, and 90. Man. And, you know, all my friends are like, really? Except for I had two friends that loved Jim Croce, my best friend still to this day. And we have a video, I think, that you guys are going to play, 365 Horses. I actually wrote that song about my best friend. But he loved Jim Croce, too. So we used to, if you rode in my car anywhere, you were going to listen to Jim Croce or you were going to get out.
Right.
Or
Dan Seals came along a little bit later. But I love Dan Seals, definitely. But Dan Seals was probably, you know, that came along in the early 90s, probably
right.
91 for me anyway.
Talking to Steve earlier, before we started the show tonight, we both found out that we have a strong love for Dan Seals.
Mm-hmm.
God rest his soul. Loved his music. And later on, Shayne, Steve volunteered to play one of my all-time favorite songs, Everything That Glitters Is Not Gold. I just love that song.
I saw your face lighten up when he said he'd play it. You're like a kid in a candy store.
I'm totally nervous now. Now you're putting the pressure on me.
No, there's no pressure there at all.
There's no pressure at all. We're just a bunch of good old boys sipping on some whiskey, talking music, and whatever else comes to mind.
Yeah, that's the thing that we love about this podcast is, I don't know if you heard the story, and we've told it in a couple of the episodes about how this whole thing got started, but really this was Tom's idea. It was 3-4 years ago because, you know, he and I are hunting partners,
mm-hmm.
and so we'd go out west a few times a year to hunt antelope or elk or deer or whatever, and he always said, hey, we both love hunting, we both love country music, we should do a podcast where we talk about those two subjects because there's a lot of hunting podcasts, there's a lot of music-related podcasts, but nobody's doing the two together.
And the two go hand in hand, usually.
It's synonymous,
typically,
right?
Typically do, yeah.
And so it was this last August, we're in a blind, and the sun's just starting to break the horizon, and you imagine we got the camo, and it's still pretty dark out, we got our bows and our face paint and all that stuff. And he looks over to me, he's like, hey,
come on
now. Let me do that podcast. Just like, what? Yeah, so then we spent the whole fall setting up the studio, testing equipment, like all that stuff. So,
and those of you that know me know that I would never use that type of language.
Never. No. Have you seen the Karina Kern episode yet? Did you watch it last week? Yeah, so when you watch it, you're going to die laughing because Danny took the two times you did drop the F-bomb.
Yeah.
And she dubbed over it with... Three times?
Yeah. Yep.
She dubbed over it with, come on now.
Did you realize, like, I have to tune that in and watch it.
That word might slip out of me once in a while, but I assure you it won't happen during the podcast.
Oh, you're fine.
Yeah, Scout's honor on that. So
we have Danny.
Yeah. Well, they were giving me grief, and so I just had to say, F off.
We kept poking. We're like, have a little fun, have a little fun. And then, it, you know, then the handcuffs came off, and he was all about it.
You poke the bear long enough, you're going to get it. So, yeah.
So guitar, Jim Croce is kind of like that, let's break the ice there. You work through that. Mm-hmm. And then do you start playing guitar in that band or in other bands?
I didn't play any guitar in a band until probably 95, and that would have been bass. I played a little bit of acoustic. I was in a band called The Forgotten. It was a rock band, 80s rock band, and they hired me to play bass, which I did. And then during the course of that band, I started playing acoustic guitar because we were doing some Skid Row. So we were doing I Remember You, and I was singing it.
I used to love Skid Row. You were singing Sebastian Bach.
Oh, yeah, I used to do it. Yeah,
maybe you disagree, but I think Sebastian Bach is, if not the best rock voice all time, he's got to be in the conversation.
There's a couple of names that come to mind for me, and Sebastian Bach, for a metal guy,
yeah,
is probably my all-time favorite.
Amazing.
But you can't discount people like Steve Perry.
Oh, Steve Perry.
Mickey
amazing.
Thomas from Starship, yep, is unbelievable. Yeah, and still to this day is unbelievable. Dennis DeYoung is still to this day unbelievable. And one of my favorites, which everybody kind of laughs when I say this name, which I don't understand because he's a super, super huge soundtrack guy, Kenny Loggins.
Oh, yeah. Oh,
Kenny Loggins has had, well, I don't know if it is anymore, but he had one of the best voices ever. I love Kenny Loggins.
Did you know that I was having some trouble with my computer, so I changed all my passwords to Kenny, and now I have all Kenny Loggins?
Okay, where's that?
I was just going to say.
I was waiting for it. I knew
you
it was coming.
You set me up. I had to take it.
I went and saw Kenny Loggins. You know, my old roommate, Randy Levy, used to have a lot of shows come to the Minneapolis. You know, Randy had Shone Productions, Rose Productions, mm-hmm, and he brought Kenny Loggins, and I tagged along with him for that show, and it was just one monster hit after another. It was like Kenny Loggins is phenomenal. Well, anybody in the music industry, he's got to be in their top 10 list.
Well, between Loggins and Messina and Kenny Loggins just as a solo artist and all the soundtracks.
Yeah.
I mean, you can't hardly watch a movie without having a Kenny Loggins
song.
Well,
I was going to say Top Gun, like, well, iconic,
Top
right?
Top Gun, Footloose, Caddyshack, you know. I mean, unbelievable. But I listen to how he sings and his voice and how everything just comes so easy for him. He's
phenomenal.
Just unbelievable. Yeah.
Did you guys ever have Kenny at the Wii Fest?
Kenny Loggins?
Yeah.
No.
He's not really country, but.
No, but we've always, every year, I don't know when it started. It started when we had the Everly Brothers there. The first time we had the Everly Brothers booked, see, we wanted to do a rock and roll act as well. We just wanted to mix one, kind of one that crossed over, mm-hmm, and the Everly Brothers.
You had Skinner in there 1 year. I was like, that's awesome.
And then the Everly Brothers, the first time, couldn't make it. So guess who came in their place? And I was like on cloud nine, Roy Orbison.
Oh, what?
Wow.
So Roy
Orbison. Talk about a voice.
So ever since that, you talk about one of the greatest
iconic
of all times. Mm-hmm. Ever since then, you know, we had guys like Johnny Rivers. We had the Doobie Brothers. We just mix in rock and roll.
Doobie
acts.
Brothers. There's another one. That's the Doobies. Like, they were big in that same. I mean, not Jim Croce era, but Kenny Loggins era.
Yeah, yep.
Sing it. 70s singer song. You could probably tell that I'm huge into that 70s singer song.
Oh,
thing. I grew up in it. My parents listened to that kind of stuff and old country. But I do have
you like Steely Dan.
Oh, absolutely.
Okay.
Donald Fagen is him. I can't remember what the guitar player's name is, but Donald Fagen and that guitar player, the two of them are so cerebral when it comes to music. It's ridiculous.
My father loves Steely Dan.
I can't even. I would like be like, I'm not worthy. You know, they're just so good. But When you mention the Doobie Brothers, they were playing there the same day that High Noon played at WeFest in 2002,
right.
And I do have a funny story about that if you want to hear it.
Yes!
Sometime later. I don't know if you want me to tell it now.
Yeah, let's
but
go!
So High Noon's on stage in 2002 at WeFest, and I'm up there doing my thing, and I break a string. I always carry a backup guitar. I actually spent a lot of money on having two almost identical guitars, so they sound basically the same. So the sound techs didn't have a heck of a time. If
right.
I had to switch guitars, I didn't have two wirelesses, so I just plug into the old one. So anyway, I'm up on stage, and it's WeFest, and it's a pretty early time slot, so mm-hmm. There's probably 3,500 people out there, but it's a big show for us, and people
Absolutely.
Are really digging it, right?
It's a big stage,
and it's a big deal. I was having so much fun. So I break this string, and I'm like,
high E or low E?
Holy
no, not
crap.
Low E.
No, it was actually my G string. there's a joke in their eyes.
Well, I knew that was coming.
So I take a second in between songs.
He's the new king.
I grab my other guitar, and it's out of tune because it's been sitting in the sun.
Sure.
Oh, no.
So I'm starting to play it. But in between songs, I went over, and the Doobie Brothers guitar tech is sitting back off the side of the stage
right.
and kind of just doing guitar tech stuff. He's restringing a guitar. And I said, I walked over to him in between songs quick, and I said, can you please? I said, my briefcase is right here. I said, can you please just quickly put a G string on my guitar? Please, 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 please. And he looks at me and he goes, sure. And I turned around. And I started playing, and I'm like,
did you know who he was at that point?
No clue. I had
just he's a tech. Clearly,
I just knew. Well, I knew he was a tech for them, but
oh.
I didn't know. I never talked to him, and I kept looking back. Never once touched my guitar. Never even tried.
Really?
And I was like, I was so disappointed. It was a simple request, and you know, I understand he's in the big leagues. And I was super, super not. I was in Little League T-ball at that point.
Yeah, but
compared
that's,
to them.
Yeah, that doesn't
but,
matter.
But he wouldn't do it. But the way he goes, sure. I was like, okay, that's either good or bad. I'm not sure how I should take that. But yeah, certainly he didn't do it.
So were you
that's
able?
Too
to,
bad.
Were you able to get the guitar back at all?
No,
in tune
not
at all?
Not that one. I got my other guitar in tune, but we had to just take a second for me to just quickly plug in my tuner and do that. But you know, when you're doing a show like that, something like WeFest, where it's that big and you're so stoked about it, and there's a lot of people watching, you don't want to take that, you know, 30 seconds it takes to get that one
right.
string or two strings that went out of tune because your guitar got wonky because it was in the sun. You just don't want to take that time to do it.
You know, it's sad to hear that story because, you know, if it would have been a country music band that was the headliner that night, there was a real good chance he would absolutely, yeah. I mean, he might have even done it when he saw you struggling
mm-hmm.
with it. He said, why don't you give that to me? Because that's the way they are. But it was always the difference between country music and rock and roll. Rock and roll, there was just these attitudes and egos, and in country music, there wasn't.
Right.
I mean, there is now. But back in the day, man, you know, the Johnny Cashes, and even in the 80s with the Dan Seals and those, they were so obliging and so kind. Anyone would help anyone out.
Well, that was...
you would have.
That WeFest show that I did in 2002, that was the only one I ever got to play. But there are a couple of stories that I got from that we should probably talk about that you'd probably enjoy.
Sure.
You know, maybe not now, maybe later if you got time. But, yeah, in fact, I met Pat Simmons from the Doobie Brothers after we got done playing.
Uh-huh.
I was backstage, and we had the all-access passes. And Pat Simmons mm-hmm. comes off the bus, and I don't really know the Doobie Brothers. So I knew he was in the Doobie Brothers, and I knew he was a guitar player, and he sang.
Right.
So I said, hey, how you doing? I'm Steve with High Noon. I just got done playing up there. Did you get a chance to hear me? And he goes, no, man, I just got up. I was taking a nap. And I'm like, oh, cool. And I said, you're the guitar player, right? I don't know what your name is. And he goes, it's Pat. And I was like, I'm so failing at this. And I said, well, I love the Doobie Brothers, man. I really hope you guys have a good show. You know, we were warming up for you guys, so hopefully you have a great time. You know, and he's like, thanks, man. You know, and that, I mean, that was my brush with fame with him. So, but he was a nice enough guy.
He's probably half awake or whatever.
Yeah, he was
probably stoned.
That could have been it too. He might have
both.
Might have had a little bit of ganja there. No smoke came out when he opened the bus door, but he came right off his bus.
That's awesome.
Well, when we had the Doobie Brothers back in hospitality in the press tent where they sign autographs and they do an interview, they couldn't have been nicer. I mean, every mm-hmm. single one of them was like, can I sign this? What can I do here? And they were like, just on it. And
because the bigger the band, usually the nicer the guys.
Yeah, exactly.
You tend to think. I mean, that doesn't always play true.
Right.
But, you know, they've been around. They've done everything. There's nothing else that they can do. I mean, the Doobie Brothers are a staple. So they are super, super good band.
Like you say, the bigger the band. I mean, I'm that got me thinking, like, in 83 when we started out with Alabama. You know, they were as big as the Beatles were.
The first Wii Fest, Alabama.
Well, and Alabama was headlining the night that we were this same night. So that's actually one of my stories that's coming up.
Yeah, they were absolutely three of the nicest guys you'll ever meet. And
yep.
I could say that about 90-some percent of all the entertainers. The big ones, they're just wonderful people.
Yep. And they were playing a good festival.
Yeah.
I tell you what, Wii Fest, we did a lot of them in High Noon. You know, we did Cornstalk, Windstalk, Country Jam or Country Fest. I can't remember whatever the one is.
There's two of them.
Kadat's but, Fest.
Yeah. So it was the one in Kadat. And you know, Wii Fest, when we got there, we were treated like human beings. And everything was awesome. I mean, it was like we were the headliner for that night, and that's I will always thank you guys for that, because it was one of my greatest moments in life to be able to do that.
Nice.
And one of my most memorable things, because it was by far the largest show I'd ever played.
One thing I like to do for the Midwest bands, especially for the regional acts, I made sure they got to do an encore. And these days it's kind of hard to do, because for some reason the whole genre of music,
they don't have Lynn Kitty running the stage schedule anymore.
They decided that because sometimes musicians are a little lazy.
Ah, what do you mean?
They decided to start with this. I mean, we had a history of maybe 25 out of the 34 years, or maybe even 30 out of the 35 years, where every single act did an encore. Even acts that didn't do encores, like Roy Clark and like Hank Thompson, they came back and did an encore. And
nice.
It was like just a thing with the Wii Fest. The crowd would not shut up until they came back out, and they always did. And then all of a sudden someone started getting a little, well, we don't want to step on the toes of the headliners. And I'm like, what? What lazy jackass started that deal? I said, you can do an encore here if you want. This is our stage.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and no, well, then that trend continued, and now I don't think any of them do an encore unless they're a headliner anymore.
Yeah, we certainly didn't in the festivals that we did this year. Never got an encore, but we didn't do a main stage with Lakes Jam this year. But we did the main stage at Iconic Fest, and we didn't get that opportunity. It was you get your songs done, and then you get off the stage
when
the time is done. But I totally understand. You know, John Conley was coming up after us. I don't want to step on John Conley's toes. I mean, talking to another guy with a voice that's
John Conley would have let you play all night long.
He was a super nice guy too.
He's as mellow as they come.
Yep, very very nice guy. When I met him backstage, he was a super cool guy. So,
yeah, what talk about classics.
Yep. Oh, every song he played, I remember. I can actually remember sitting in my dad's old blue pickup truck listening to most of those songs.
Yeah, absolutely.
He was so big in the late 70s, and then maybe just a little bit in the early 80s there. But Backside of 30, I mean, come on, that's a great tune. That's a great song.
When we sold the Wii Fest, I did a couple, 2 or 3 years up at Country Fest, and we had John Conley one of those years, and what a treat.
Yep.
Just, I mean, it's like one of those things, you just get goosebumps, you know, listening to him sing all those classics.
So you obviously play drums, or had played drums, and acoustic and bass. You play a little electric or bass, or not bass, baritone, any of that stuff? Like, you mix it in with that?
I am terrible. I have no problem saying I am terrible at electric guitar. I just can't do it.
Would Brian agree with that?
Oh, yeah. And on an acoustic guitar, you know, if I'm not finger picking, I'm more of a beater. So, you know, I strum so hard that, you know, my old guitars, I used to leave a little pile of sawdust on the stage because I was like Willie Nelson's Trigger, right. You know, his guitar. I think it's Trigger, isn't it? Isn't that what he calls it?
Yep.
It's got them holes in it. If I would have played my guitars long enough, they would look just like that because I just strum, and I use super thin picks, but I just strum that hard.
We have a pick for you tonight, by the way.
Oh, do you?
Yeah, we have some Boots and Backstraps picks.
Nice. I like it.
Yeah, so.
You want to know how I know Willie Nelson calls his guitar Trigger? One year we had him, and they were filming a movie at the Wii Fest. It was called the Dill Scallion Movie. It was a spoof on Spinal Tap.
Oh, okay.
Willie Nelson was in it. Henry Winkler.
What was there was another spoof that they did on Spinal Tap. Do you remember what it was called?
I don't.
Oh.
I just remember at Spinal Tap, the drummer spontaneously combusts, and it's like the funniest thing ever.
Yeah, that was the spoof. Spinal Tap was the spoof.
Yeah, Spinal Tap is a spoof. Yeah. This was called Hilarious. The Dill Scallion. And Willie came out, and someone that has a better memory than I, it was at least 8 encores. It might have been 10. But every time he'd come out, or the last couple times he came out, he had his guitar strap over his shoulder, and his guitar was on the ground behind him. And he'd say, "Come on, Trigger, we're going to do a little more." And he'd pull that guitar up, and he'd put it on again. He says, "You know, I'll stay here all night long if you want me to." And nice. He just kept playing song.
But did he yell, "Hi ho, Silver"? I mean, that's what he had to, right?
I don't know.
All right, so... We're in the Steve Kretsinger timeline. We're like senior year of high school now. When do we make that jump into, okay, I'm getting more serious about live performance?
What really sparked it for me, and I always wanted to be a traveling, playing gigs musician in high school. It was always the goal.
To meet what, chicks.
And that's the
He
main
met a
reason.
Good one. He met that's a good the, one.
Yeah, Gentry is awesome.
We got to give Gentry like her due here. She is fantastic.
Especially
we love
since I wrecked her truck today. But we'll go there sometime.
Do you have a Danny? Do we have a picture of Gentry?
Oh, I don't think I sent a picture of my fantastic bride, but I can get
I
one
send
on my
pictures
phone.
Of this
we
one
have
everywhere.
Google, and she has Facebook in there.
Oh, she does. Yeah.
She same got, last she, name.
My wife's got awesome hair.
I'll stalk her.
Yeah, do that.
Speaking of spouses, Tom wanted to throw this out there.
Oh, yeah. Nice.
That's when he threw that pitch out the Twins game.
Yeah, that's Lynn and I and the
PC Bear.
Shirt. Yeah, I had a picture of myself and Lynn and Ron Gardenhire, who happened to be a pretty good friend of mine because he's was the neighbor with Tommy DeRay at the Hog's Breath. And
love Gardy.
So he'd come up to the Hog's Breath and help us out and bring some of the players up.
Speaking of guys that beat cancer, Ron Gardenhire.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I know his daughter, Tiffany, pretty well. She's moved back to Oklahoma where they're from. But,
right.
But, yeah, we stayed in touch. And, you know, she used to come to the shows back in the day quite a bit.
Right.
And so.
So, anyway, when I transferred my phone, one of my phones, the picture got. There's just a teeny part of the picture.
Yeah.
So I don't know how the heck that happens, but I was kind of bummed out because I really liked that picture.
Right.
Nice memory.
Yeah. All right, so not to meet chicks. But you're like, I want to be a road warrior, right?
I realized when I picked up a guitar and when I was playing drums that the girls are in the front. They're not hanging out in the back. Now, I was a singing drummer, so
nobody can name the bassist in the band.
Right. So my goal when I was a drummer was I wanted to be Phil Collins because Phil Collins was a singing drummer.
Right,
you know,
right.
great. I loved Phil Collins. But what really sparked me. And
he's another guy that plays like 15 instruments.
Yeah, he plays everything and plays them well.
Yeah.
But Johnny Holm.
Yep.
Oh,
Johnny
yes.
Holm and the Traveling Fun Show changed my life. And it was one of my ex-girlfriend who, we were at Valley Fair one time, and she was like, "I want to go watch this band." And I'm like, "I don't want to watch the band. I want to ride the rides. I'm at Valley Fair to ride rides. I'm not here to sit down and watch this stupid band," right? So she talked me into going and watching Johnny Holm. Well, Johnny Holm in the amphitheater at Valley Fair back then, this would have been 1989, and he would And he did this at his shows too. If anybody in the audience knows anybody that's got any talent at all, point them out.
Every show he'd do that.
So my girlfriend at the time points at me. So Johnny Holm comes out and he gets me and he brings me up on stage. And I was always a reasonably adequate singer, you know. So he goes.
He's so humble, TK. He's a great singer.
He wants to do, you know, Johnny Holm would do this thing where you're doing Unchained Melody. So he would go.
Oh, start with something easy.
Love, you know, and he'd do that part, and then he'd hold the microphone out to you, and you would start singing. So I started singing, and he goes, "Whoa," you know, like that. You know, when I started singing. So he has me sing Bad, Bad Leroy Brown.
All right.
Of all songs, Jim Croce.
Right.
My idol. He I think he thought that I wouldn't know this song. I'm 18 years old, 17 years old, and I absolutely know Bad, Bad Leroy Brown, right? So I sing this whole song, right, in front of the amphitheater, and Johnny Holm has me standing on this box, because I'm kind of a short guy. So he has me standing on this box. And when I get done, he holds my arm up like I'm Rocky, like Rocky in the statue, right? And he goes, go run around the amphitheater. And I got a standing ovation, and he had me run through the audience all the way through that amphitheater and slap hands with everybody, and I went and sat down, and I was like,
what just
holy
happened?
Crap.
You're like, what just happened?
Yeah, and literally, when I joined High Noon, my goal was I wanted to be the Johnny Holm of the country scene. So when I joined High Noon, I bought a wireless microphone.
Yep.
I told them guys, I said, I'd like to get out in the audience. I'd like to start singing out there. I'd like to just, you know, move out there and just get people going.
Yeah, no offense to Bob, but you were definitely like the entertainer in the band.
They were like, Go nuts, man. If you want to go out in the audience, you go right ahead. We're going to stay up here where it's safe, you know.
Yeah.
So, but, you know, that was really the big turning point for me. And then at that point, you know, it was a couple of years. I played in a couple of bands that never played out. But I started doing some solo acoustic shows, and then I joined my rock band in 95. And soon after that, I became the house musician for... I played there for 15 years. It was a restaurant called Panino's in North Oaks. And it's an Italian restaurant.
It's still there, I think,
and
isn't
yes, it?
Yes,
it is, and it's fantastic food. But Chet, the owner of Panino's, unfortunately, has died of cancer.
Oh.
But he used to have me come in there and play on Friday nights. And, you know, North Oaks, Kevin McHale used to come in all the time.
Yep.
And, you know, North Oaks, you're right by the golf course. So there was a lot of people there. So I used to make a lot of money in tips. And
one of the wealthiest communities in
the
state.
It was right in my wheelhouse because it was all 70s singer-songwriter stuff. Chet was always like, don't get too excited in here. You know, don't play too loud. You don't have to play anything too fast. This is dinner music. And I'm like, I'm on it, man. And Chet loved Jim Croce. I mean, so Jim Croce's kind of come into play all my life. You know, it's kind of funny how it
worked
out.
Do you have a Jim Croce tattoo somewhere in your body?
I haven't. My body is my temple. There's no tattoos on this body, okay? I have not.
I neither.
Done that, so, yeah.
What about you?
What about that birthmark that looks like Roy Orbison?
I don't know if I want to see that or not.
I have a great, great joke, but I don't know if I can get away with it. You know, I can tell the joke, and if Danny doesn't like it, she can edit it,
She'll
I guess.
Chop it. She'll chop it.
So there's this gal who always dreamed of meeting Elvis and Roy Orbison, and you know, she just thought, well, it's never going to happen. I'm getting older, and so she thought, you know, maybe the best idea, maybe I can have them tattooed on my thighs there, and then I'll have Roy Orbison and Elvis Presley.
I don't like where this is going.
And right where I want them. And so she got to drinking one night, and she's sitting outside on a bench, and you know, she's kind of bumming her out that she can't show anybody because it's just not ladylike. And there was this kind of a wino laying down on the ground there. She looked around and she said, hey, you want to see something? She pulls up her dress and she says, what do you think of these guys? And the guy looked back and forth. He goes, well, I recognize Willie Nelson in the middle, but who are them other two guys?
Oh, no. Oh, no.
Oh, that's got to stay in. That can't get chopped out. That's hilarious.
Yeah, I don't think the FCC is going to go after you for that, are they? Isn't that who it is, the FCC? Oh. I don't know all my
acronyms. You want to hear the black version?
No!
Well, you got to hear it. No. I recognize Don King in the middle, but who are the other two?
When I want to get on my wife's nerves, I say, geez, you know, you might want to shave your armpits. Looks like you got buckwheat in the headlock.
Oh, yeah. That one's a classic. I like that.
Oh. Yeah, there's my lovely bride.
Oh my goodness!
That's not her fancy haircut though. She's got that Sonic the Hedgehog kind of haircut now.
She's beautiful.
Yep. There it is. Yep. There's the GI I know and love.
It. What's her? Yeah, give her company a shout out too, because she made some great stuff.
She does stuff for a company called BG's, but she also has just G's, where she knits and crochets. I mean, you name it, she does. She does all sorts of stuff right now. I shouldn't even mention this. She's going to kill me for doing this. But she made – it's the funniest thing that took off like crazy. She sells a million of these things. She makes these yarned or crocheted – they're doobies, right? So they look like a doobie. They're about 5 inches long, and they're about this big around. So it looks like a blunt, you know?
Yeah.
And she fills them with you
for
know,
a guy that doesn't
and,
do any drugs, right. You sure know the lingo.
She fills them with the batting, the pillow batting. And catnip, and she sells them as catnip doobies. Yeah, they're there.
Oh, and that is hilarious.
These things sell like crazy. So all the time she's like, "Oh my god, I just sold another 9 catnip doobies, and I don't have any left." So she will literally sit on the couch and watch the twins, and just whip these things out. She's watching the twins.
She must be cussing the entire time.
I don't know why she loves that team.
Oh, there you go.
There's my cat Henry. He eats very well, and he does
old
like
fat
the,
cat.
Yep, and the cats apparently just go ape shit for these. Can I say that?
Yeah, you can.
They just go nuts for these things. So
that's
my
awesome.
My dog doesn't care anything about it, but the cat just absolutely loves those.
That's
things.
Hilarious.
My wife, she's a big crocheter. She just gave her an idea.
Yeah.
She makes blankets for all the family.
Oh, blankets. You know, my wife does once in a while, she'll do a blanket, but they take so long, and then they're hot when they're laying on you when you're doing them.
Yeah.
But she does a lot of hats and a lot of scarves, a lot of cowls and things like that. And she goes and does some trade shows once in a while. But she sells on Etsy and on Amazon. Those catnip doobies are one of the dumbest things. And she actually made catnip carrots. And I thought the catnip carrots were a super cool idea because they look just like the doobies, but they're orange and they have a little carrot top on them.
Yeah.
I was like, those things are going to sell like wildfire. That is the coolest thing. Yep. I don't think she
we have
sold,
a good producer.
She might have had like one. Yeah, you are. She's on the ball, man. You are awesome.
Great producer.
Kudos. Kudos to you back there. Let me give you.
Yes, Danny.
Your own sound effect.
So hopefully the shameless plug for my wife's crocheting will get me past the fact that I backed into a sign at McDonald's.
It can't hurt. So. It can't
Etsy?
Hurt.
What's your Etsy
company? You know what? That's where I can't help you. I think it's under BG's. If you look up BG's in Etsy,
okay.
And maybe Amazon as well. I wish I had brought a card. And now I'm probably going to be in trouble because I don't know.
No.
But
we'll figure it out on the break, and then
she's got awesome stuff. Yep. Yeah. There it is. Yep.
I told you she's good.
Man, she is super, super good. Yep. That's it. Gentry Custom Crochet.
Nice.
That's a cool hat.
So she makes hats that we have these little leather tags. My brother's got a laser scriber, a laser burner thing at his house in Grantsburg. So I made her a bunch of these leather tags with G's in them, and then wood tags in Minnesota. Scribed into them, and she does little hats like that and puts them tags on them too. So her hats, you know, there's some other woman hat that has some letter on there. I don't know what it is, or some kind of tag. Hers have the G on there. So, yep. I don't know that that's one of hers. That doesn't look like Gentry stuff.
Huh. It's on her Etsy. I don't know.
Is it? Well,
maybe it's a different.
Maybe somebody's hacking into her Etsy now.
I'll figure it out.
Oh, China hacks into everything is probably that.
Right?
You're right.
In Russia.
You're right. That wasn't hers. Don't tell her.
Shh. Oops.
Just edit that out.
Yeah, exactly. That's getting the chopping block. All right. So you're getting a live performance. We're moving through. You're in a rock band, right?
Yep. I was in a rock band called The Forgotten for about 3.5 years, playing bass, singing lead. Boston, like I said, some Skid Row. I mean, everything that was super high. I was still a pretty young man at the time, so I was, you know, mid-20s at that point.
Just pinch your knees together real hard and hit those notes.
You know, and was I, yeah,
just there, to redeem myself. Yep. Just to redeem myself.
And that is a super cool hat. I love that.
It is a cool hat. There,
so, yeah.
It looks like it's super soft, too.
And the yarn that she uses, that's one thing. I go out and I help her do her sales stuff, so she'll put out a table, and, you know, I tell, for one thing, I'm like, yeah, I crocheted all this stuff. You know, I tell, when the ladies come up, you know, because she's shy. You know, I mean, she's not, if you get a couple of drinks in her, my wife will, she's been known
to tear up the dance floor. Yes.
But I like to talk. So I get up and I'm like, you know, people will be looking, but they don't want to touch. And I'm like, I want to sell this stuff. I want to make sure she's making money. So I'm like, you got to feel that. Put your hands on it. If you touch that hat, you're gonna walk away with that
sales
hat.
101.
It is totally all the yarn that she uses is super, super soft. I love it, the soft stuff. Now, I say that I don't wear, Gentry wants me to wear her hats, and there's a specific reason why I don't, is because my mom has, and she'll probably see this, but my mom, I think, has some selective memory. She, when I was a kid, got into knitting.
Okay.
And she knitted me these mittens, right? I didn't have cool gloves like the other kids had. I had these mittens.
Choppers.
Yes, and that's exactly what they were. So if you try and have a snowball fight with knitted mittens in sticky snow, you throw the snowball and your glove doesn't come back. Okay, and
just the glove launch.
And
then you're yelling like, "Give me my glove!"
Yeah, and once you throw it at your friend, they're not giving it back. You know, they're like, "No, you're making snowballs with cold hands." But the first snowball you make that's got sticky snow or wet snow, those gloves are saturated.
Yeah.
I absolutely hate wet gloves, wet socks. That's one of my pet peeves. I hate it, hate it, hate it. So she wants me to wear her hats. I love her stuff. She does great work. Everybody who buys her stuff, she gets awesome reviews. Everything is super soft, but she is super not happy with me that I won't wear her hats. And there's
redemption there, bro.
Well, hopefully, but I mean, I think one day, if I tip over, you know, if I circle the drain and tip over unexpectedly, in my coffin, she's going to put a Bee Gees hat on me. She's going to make something that just to make sure that by the time I get planted, I'm going to be wearing one of her hats.
She
would do that for me, I'm sure.
Oh, that's super fantastic.
You know, when we were talking earlier, Steve, we were talking about High Noon, and we've been talking about High Noon quite a bit. But, you know, I met the original High Noon. We had them perform at the Wii Fest several times. Mm-hmm. And I became good friends with him because Darren liked to hunt.
Yep.
So I actually got him into bear hunting. And, you know, we just all became friends. And when my wife and I, 30 years ago, got married, they came and played in the basement of the Mermaid where I had a wedding reception. We actually got married in St. Thomas, but then had a big reception here.
Awesome.
In Minnesota. Yeah. And High Noon came and played, and they were the original High Noon. And there's been so many people in High Noon, and periodically over the years they'd come up and perform at the Wii Fest, like mm-hmm. you, and then we've got Nick Hoffman, and his new television—not new, but his successful.
I think he's been on there 3 or 4 years now, but yeah, super successful. Nick's super Wild Ride. Yep.
He went to play with, as you may or may not know, Kenny Chesney, and he was Kenny Chesney's right-hand man.
Yep.
I mean, I guess what I'm getting at is there was so much talent.
Did you mind sharing the stage with him?
What's that?
Did you mind sharing the stage with him?
Oh, it was pretty fun.
The Kenny Chesney.
I guess what I'm getting at is there was so much talent that came out of that band.
Yeah, on that picture, if you look next to Bob, who's got the long blonde hair in the middle, on his right, as you're looking at the picture, that's Nick Hoffman right there that played with us from 98 to 2000, and then he went and played with Kenny Chesney for 10 years, and he's got, like Tom Katt said, his own television show called Nick's Wild Ride now. And
can
then
you
next,
start, Steve, I'm sorry to interrupt you,
yep,
but can
problem.
You start from the left? I have eye issues, that's why
I see Brian poking out behind
from,
there.
From the left, mm-hmm. in the front, is that's Izzy.
Okay.
He was our keyboard player at that time, and then tucked out behind him is Brian Olson, the guitar player.
Okay.
And then next to Brian was Woody, that's Pete Peterson. And then it looks like next to him was Jason Reardon, who was our light guy at that time. And then Bob is in the blue shirt with the long blonde hair. And then that's Nick next to him, Nick Hoffman. And then next to him is Danny Hulkholter, who left us and went and played with Lone Star for about a year and a half. And then he played with Gretchen Wilson for, I think, three. And he plays with Dirk Bentley now. And he was actually, if you watch the, I think it was the CMAs, they did the tribute to Charlie Daniels with Jason Aldean. That was Danny that was playing fiddle on that. That was his, so he was our fiddle player from 2000 to 2002. And then down there in the front in the white shirt, that's young me.
Uh-huh.
Oh, that's you.
And then
who's that 12-year-old next to you?
Down there, that's Casey. He was our sound guy at that time. That's and then next up above him with the glasses, that's Rocky
Robeson.
Okay,
he's a roadie, right?
Rocky was a roadie for us. Yeah, that was one of the good things about High Noon is, you know, when as a band member, we just showed up, plugged in our guitars and played, and you know, for a long time, we had six people in the road crew. That would take care of hauling all the equipment, driving the truck. We had a truck, you know, that hauled all of our stuff. So it was
like a cargo truck.
It was as close to big time as I think you could get as a regional act. I mean, there were a couple other. I think there was a band called Something Below Zero.
32
Below. Yeah, they had a bus.
They're actually at WeFest this year, TK.
I was super jealous of their bus, but. You know, I drove a Z28. I had a 95 Z28, so I could go faster than their bus. So.
Hard to beat a Camaro, man.
Yeah, right. Well, I have a Mustang now, but yeah, we won't talk.
I was liking them to the. I don't know. I think of some of the biggest bands that come out, country bands like Daisy Dillman,
mm-hmm.
High Noon, certainly, and
Killer Hayseeds.
Killer Hayseeds. Yep.
Forever, it was you guys and the Killer Hayseeds.
Yep. For a little while, we had Chase Roberts out there. I don't even know. I don't know what happened to Chase Roberts. I haven't seen or heard anything from him. If he's around the area, maybe he moved out of state. But yeah, Chase Roberts. Chase Roberts was around for quite a while doing the circuit with us. And then, you know, as High Noon got older, before we disbanded, it started to be Rocky Lynn started to make his name out there. Certainly, the Farmer's Daughters came along in that area. Matt Neef and Heidi
for Hitchville.
And you know, I used to sing with Matt Neef and Jolene. In a band called Mirror Image, they were doing
I did not know that.
It was a karaoke band, so I knew them from that. It's such an incestuous business when you've been in it for a long time. Everybody kind of knows everybody, you know. Obviously, I met you through the music. You know, I came out and seen some of your shows. And
can I share a fun story about that?
Sure, yep.
I'm going to interject this, and we have talked a little bit about this, TK, in the show, about how Steve and his wife, Gentry, are just the salt of the earth, the best kind of people that you'd want to know in your life.
Okay.
And I've got a great story that
Shucks.
Kind of like, yeah. it's the truth, man. So right from the time that I met, it's like when I was first getting into the local scene as a live performer, because I've been in the music business here locally since the early 90s, but when I made the decision to start going live, it was like I wanted to just talk to all these guys that were already successful. That's what you do, right? Pick mm-hmm. their brains. So Ross, who was the bass player for Killer Hayseeds at the time, and then he passed away.
Unfortunately, yep.
Yeah,
Ross was a good guy.
Florent, right?
I don't remember what his last name was.
Yeah, anyway, so he was a guy that would just sit down with me on their breaks and just let me talk and pick his brain, and Steve was another one of those guys where I kind of clanged on to Steve with High Noon, and we became friends, and he introduced me to Bob, and then Bob, of course, is an open book, too. Super good dude. The one of the first times I talked to Bob, we're just like, having a conversation and getting along really well or whatever. He brings me over to their like merch area and just gives me a shirt. Oh man, here you go, man, wear this. And I was like, what? They're selling them for $30 in their little merch booth, and sure. He just gives me one.
Well, you know, it's free publicity though.
Yeah. Just like that's the kind of people that we're talking about, Tom, just to echo what you said before about how in a country community, it's just a different
Absolutely.
Breed of people. So Steve and Gene are those people to the T. So one night, my band at that time, which was North Gone South, we're playing at the, I think it was Isani American Legion.
It was either Isanti or Cambridge. It was one of those two. But yeah, I remember the night you're talking about. Yeah,
yeah. So it was a crazy snowstorm that night. Yep. We barely got the truck with the trailer and all that gear to the club. And coming in there, we're talking to the club manager, and he's like, "It's probably going to be a dead night. We're going to pay you anyway. Just if you can make it, make it, and play, and just do whatever. You know, you'll get paid." We're like, "All right, let's do it." So we ended up making it. And admittedly, there was not a lot of people there, but right front and center at a table were Steve and Gene. They drove out there through that snowstorm to watch us play.
Nice.
How cool is that? I've never forgotten that, brother.
I absolutely do remember that night. And, you know, I unfortunately sometimes I will give my opinion when it's unwanted. But, you know, I
think we're all guilty of that.
I do like to, you know, if there's something that I can help out with, I like to throw suggestions out there. But, you know, you were a great performer.
Thank you.
And I did see something on one of your podcasts where you were beating yourself up about your voice, and you had a good voice, man. I used to get out in the audience and stuff, but I sometimes when I think about how I do my thing out in the audience, it's not like I made that up. Like I said, I owe a lot of that to Johnny Holm, you know.
Yeah.
You were more of a natural at being able to entertain people, and you could do whatever you wanted to, and you weren't shy about it. You know, it was like uninhibited, just showmanship.
Thank you.
Seriously, though, you know, I heard you beating yourself about your voice, and I can't call in and say, "Come on, knock
that's
it
by
off."
Design,
you
know, that's by design,
Steve. You guys need a call line. but no, it was I absolutely remember that night, and I do. And the one funny thing, and this is just one of them random things that sometimes you just remember random things. When we walked in, the bar had back then the Wii's were a thing,
yeah.
And there were people at the bar. They had a Wii at the bar, and they were bowling, a Wii bowling at the bar.
Video game.
And I was like, for some reason, I just remember when we walked in, there were Wii bowling, and I was like, that's the weirdest thing.
Like, you know,
it's a concert. They're doing it at a bar, on the TV behind the bar, and they're Wii bowling. So, yeah, I don't know. That's totally one of my random thoughts. Yeah.
Yeah, no, and I appreciate your compliment. I really do. That means a lot.
No, I don't throw those out just willy-nilly either. You know, I'm not a guy that's going to compliment you if you don't deserve it. But, no, seriously, I absolutely mean that. And I probably told you as much when I was out there.
You did.
Sure, so.
Yeah, we talked on the break, and you actually, he was kind enough to just say, hey, do you want some? And I was like, yes, I will take any pointers or tips you got. And I think the challenge I had when we were performing live is I didn't pick enough stuff that was in my range, because I did some. There's a really good female friend of mine who now moved to the East Coast, but we used to do a few weddings together as duets,
mm-hmm.
and we would do like Keith Whitley, Alison Krauss, and I would be right in the pocket and just killing it every time because that was like my range. But then with the band, they'd always want to do Rascal Flatts and like all this stuff that was octaves out of my range, and I would just be out of voice by the first break.
Rascal Flatts, unless you're Matt Neef, and Matt Neef is by far, I would say 100% Matt Neef is the best male vocalist I have heard probably in the five-state area for a regional band. He is remarkable.
He is.
He sang Tennessee Whiskey the last time I went out and seen him over at Route 47, and I actually... It's funny. Like I said, I'm in my own musical bubble. If it's not on my iPad, I don't hardly listen to it. So he did that song. I'd never heard it before. And he did that song, and I just sat out there and went, wow.
His runs are
that
remarkable.
Is unbelievable. Yeah, the way his vocal acrobatics are stellar. I can't say enough good things about him.
You've heard Matt many times.
Oh, yeah. I didn't know who you were talking about. Actually, I never knew Matt's last name.
Neef, yeah.
Yeah. Matt is
great,
phenomenal.
Singer.
And you know, he sounds a little bit like Rascal Flatts.
Like Gary, yeah.
But he can sing anything.
Yeah.
I honestly think he can sing anything better than anybody else. He's just, I'm amazed he's not a national act. He's that good.
Do you want to hear a funny Matt Neef story?
Oh, sure. I always want to hear a funny Matt Neef story.
We were playing, I think it was called Poor Richards in Bloomington. It was a rowdy cowboy show, and it was Travis, Kid George, and I. And we're playing, and Matt and Heidi came in, and they were just having a couple of drinks. And I was just like, man, what a cool honor to have those guys in the club that night. And Matt was just walking around, and we knew them obviously pretty well from doing shows locally, and as Rowdy Cowboy Show, we would do a lot of like hosting for bands at Toby mm-hmm. Keith's and things like that when they would play.
Mm-hmm.
And so I went to Matt and I was like, "Hey, man, I'm like, if I throw like a karaoke track on. I know it's like insulting to a real singer, but would you mind singing just because we love your voice that much? And he's like, oh yeah, I'll totally do that. So like, you know, I don't know. I'm just going to round down and say 20 drinks later. And Heidi's looking at me going, don't let him sing. And I'm like, what do you mean? He's going to be fine. Yeah, no, it didn't go so well.
alcohol just ruins a lot of things.
Yeah.
Everything in moderation. You know?
It was hilarious because I promoted him. Like, this is like the whole bar. I'm like, this is one of the most talented male vocalists I've ever heard. Certainly the most talented male vocalist in this region. Like, you guys are going to love him. And then, you know, Matt Nee from Hitchville. And then Heidi's over there like this. I'm trying not to look. And we actually had a Rascal Flatts song on.
Oh yeah,
you know, because I'm like, this is his jam. He's gonna kill this. And
was it God Bless the Broken Road?
It was God Bless the Broken Road. And I'm like, this is,
no, he could do kill that song.
Yeah,
man.
Arms yeah. tied behind his back. Yeah.
Well, I think after the compliments you threw at Shayne here, maybe during the break, you two ought to pick out a song and sing together.
No.
Ooh.
No.
If Keith Whitley is in your range, I think I have a Keith Whitley song that
I am not singing on this podcast.
Yeah, you
no.
are.
Oh, you know what? If you guys are going to have me do it, maybe that'd be kind of. Do you know Don't Close Your Eyes?
No. No,
lies. I can tell he's lying.
I would have to have some kind of tablet with lyrics in front of me. I'd have to listen to it on the break. It's been so long since I sang anything.
We can do all those things, yeah.
That's not my zone anymore.
We've got nothing MC but guy. Time, right?
yeah. All right. So anyway, we are gonna take this opportunity to get to break. Is it, believe it or not, time has absolutely flown by, and we're already through an hour.
It always does.
Wow.
Yeah, it does. You know, when you're sitting with good people.
Yep.
Having a good conversation, it does tend to fly by.
Yeah.
So before we go to break, I'm going to start doing something that I don't usually do, which is to tell everybody out there to make sure you get online and hit like, hit subscribe, leave a comment, share all this stuff. It's really important to us with the social media that you're getting online and sharing and liking and commenting on the posts that we have. Jill works really hard with that stuff online. And the only way that we're going to get beyond all the big tech overlords is to have people actually commenting and sharing and liking the stuff that we post. So do us that favor on the break here, and we will be back in just a couple minutes with Steve Kretsinger. Boots and Backstraps is proudly brought to you by Homes by Shayne. Make your move with the Homes by Shayne team. Commitment to community and unparalleled customer service are the foundation of this RE/MAX Results referral-based business. Their driven team of experts communicate with their clients every step of the way, ensuring a memorable experience from the first conversation through your closing day. Go to homesbyshane.com. Let's get you home. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Boots and Backstraps. We are still in studio with our guest, Steve Kretsinger, and Steve has agreed to play some music for us, so he's got a couple songs he will play. And the first one, by request.
Man, I can't tell. You know, I didn't get to play this song often, but whenever I do a ballad, there was a few, you know, when we get the people out on a dance floor slow dancing. This song makes me, I don't know what it does to me, but I absolutely love
it.
Can
we see under the table what happens?
No, nothing like that. It's just terrible. One of my all-time favorite artists who is just the sweetest, greatest guy. And his music, we're talking about Dan Seals. And what a neat man he was. He was blind in his later on in his life, and then he finally did pass. But he left us with some of the coolest music. And this song that Steve's going to do, I get goosebumps whenever I hear it. And if you're a rodeo guy or a rancher out west or something, you relate to this song, and it probably brings a lot of people to tears. So, Steve, whatever glitters.
Briefly, can I just say one thing?
Of course you can.
We had a gentleman that used to come out and see High Noon. His name was Al Evans, and he unfortunately died of a stroke at a pretty young age.
Uh-huh.
And he used to love this song, and I actually did this one on Facebook as a tribute to him for his wife Cheryl. So this is one of the favorites of a lot of people that came out and seen High Noon, and one of my most requested songs that I got.
I'm
so
digging it.
Hopefully I can do it justice.
I think you will.
Saw your picture on a poster in a cafe out in Phoenix.
Guess you're still the sweetheart of the rodeo. As for me and little Casey, we still make the circuit in a one-horse trailer and a mobile home. She still asks about you all the time. And I guess we never even cross your mind. But oh, sometimes I think about you and the way you used to ride out in your rhinestones and your sequins, with the sunlight on your hair. No, the crowd will always love you. But as for me, I've come to know everything that glitters is not gold. Well, old Red, he's getting older, and last Saturday he stumbled. But you know, I just can't bear to let him go. Little Casey, she's still growing, and she started asking questions. And there's certain things that a man just does not know. Her birthday came and you never even called. And I guess we never cross your mind at all. But then sometimes I think about you and the way you used to ride out in your rhinestones and your sequins, with the sunlight on your hair. No, the crowd will always love you. But as for me, I've come to know everything that glitters is not gold. Everybody said you'd make it big someday, but I guess that we were only in your way. But someday I'm sure you're gonna know the cost. 'Cause for everything you win, there's something lost. But oh, sometimes I think about you and the way you used to ride out in your rhinestones and your sequins, with the sunlight on your hair. No, the crowd will always love you. But as for me, I've come to know everything that glitters is not gold. Ooh, everything that glitters is not gold.
Oh, my word.
Thank you.
That was so good, Steve. You know, as soon as you started playing, I thought, oh, that's right. He's got those crazy high notes in there.
Yeah, there's.
And I'm like, oh, man, when you hit it, I was like, golden.
About the third night of every weekend, I was a little concerned when we do that song. I'm like, I don't know what's going to come out. So.
A little squawk.
You never know.
Is that guy 13?
Yeah, right.
That was beautiful. That was absolutely
beautiful.
I appreciate
it. Thanks a lot.
I have goosebumps listening to you. What a great singer you are.
I saw your reaction. You got to that high note. You're like,
gives you happy twitches, right?
What a great song.
It's a real good feeling.
Gives me happy twitches just when I can do it.
Yeah, and you did it well. What are you going to do now? Are you going to do another one for us?
One of the other ones that, you know, most recently I've been doing it with the farmer's daughters, and Johnny, our guitar player, would come in and do some of the, like, there's a keyboard part that follows the guitar in there. It was just super, super cool, and Lindsay would sing the harmonies on it. It just, every time I played this one with the farmer's daughters, it was super cool, too. So it's a song called Love Me by Colin Ray.
Oh.
I've been doing it for a long time, but this is another one of them where, you know, you get up there a little ways when you're doing, you know, Colin Ray. Has a voice that's like an angel. I mean, he does a version of Open Arms by Journey that I gotta say I like it better than Steve Perry.
Colin Ray is another one of those artists that when you listen to all the songs, because you don't think, well, Colin Ray, well, and then all of a sudden, bang, 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 like Tracy Lawrence.
He had a lot of hits after hit.
Like so many artists, Colin Ray had a ton of hits.
Yep, Colin Ray is very good, and Little Rock and Little Red Rodeo and all the songs are just phenomenal. He's just a great guy. So I'm going to give this one a whirl.
All right.
Let me start that again.
I read a note my grandma wrote back in 1923. Grandpa kept it in his coat, and he showed it once to me. Said, boy, you might not understand, but a long, long time ago, your grandma's daddy didn't like me none, but I loved your grandma so. We had this crazy plan to meet and run away together, get married in the first town we came to and live forever, but nailed to the tree where we were supposed to meet instead. I found this letter, and this is what it said. If you get there before I do, don't give up on me. I'll meet you when my chores are through, and I don't know how long I'll be, but I'm not gonna let you down. Darling, wait and see. And between now and then, till I see you again, I'll be loving you. Love me. I read those words just hours before my grandma passed away. In the doorway of a church, where me and Grandpa stopped to pray. You know I'd never seen him cry in all my 15 years. But as he read these words to her, his eyes filled up with tears. If you get there before I do, don't give up on me. I'll meet you when my chores are through, and I don't know how long I'll be, but I'm not gonna let you down. Darling, wait and see. And between now and then, till I see you again, I'll be loving you. Love me. In between now and then, till I see you again, I'll be loving you. Love me.
weekend.
You know, I think that's about the coolest thing we've done on our podcast since we started, Shayne. That was so good. What are two great songs. I mean, my
I
wife.
I told you he's good. I told you.
I told you.
I tried to tell you.
I feel very blessed to have been a part of that and listened to you sing.
I really appreciate it. Thank you
very
much.
What a gift you have.
You guys are too kind. I'm getting a little misty right now. So.
I was getting a little misty while you were singing.
And that wasn't even like the like actual demonstration of the range of this man's voice. I've heard him do some stuff, including Journey, and shows where I'm like, what in the world? And he didn't even have his knees pushed together real hard.
Well, you couldn't see the vice grips. And that's the key is trying to hide the vice grips in tight pants.
What was the one, and I'm drawing a little bit of a blank, and I'm going to be embarrassed when you say this song, but the one you used to put Gene's name in. Me and Gene, something.
God, I used to do.
It was a rock tune, I think.
Well, I did. I put G in with Faithfully a lot.
Yes,
because it had that love and the music, man, ain't always what it's supposed to be. Which, you know, there is almost no truer line in the world because you know my wife would be the first to tell you that she used to have all kinds of people. You know, High Noon was a pretty well-known band. So
Yes. Everybody
thought, you know, High Noon, oh, you guys must make a lot of money. You guys are like almost famous, you know. So everybody puts you up here. And so they would tell G, oh, you're so lucky. You're so lucky. I bet you he sings to you all the time. And Gentry's like, no, he never sings to me, actually. And when he does, I do a song that I don't even know what the name of it is, but it's about actually sitting on the toilet. So, you know, because I have a hard time. I love my wife.
Yes, of course.
I always have, you know. But it's hard for me to sit in front of her and do a sappy song. I don't know why, because I can do it in front of anybody else. But
right. There's a
Dan Fogelberg song that I do called "Believe in Me" that she really really likes. So I do dedicate that. And I actually put that on my Facebook page. My sound guy recorded a little bit of that, and I have it on my Facebook page. But you know, my wife will be the first person when people say that. And this is, she's going to kill me for saying this, but this is my wife's line to a lot of these people. You know, she would say, you know, people be like, you are so lucky. And she'd say, yeah, he shits like everybody else, which I totally love it. It's like, because, you know, if people think that, you know, musicians in general, even at a top level, are any different than anybody else.
Right.
They're not. They're people. And literally, they put their socks on left and right. My socks have actually an L and an R, so I know which feet to put my socks on. Nobody's more special than anybody else.
No.
And in all
you
all,
seem like a good time, though.
Well, it's
oh, look at this picture here.
Yeah.
Steve.
Well, I was kind of a clown, but all in all, we only have one person to answer to.
That's
and
a
one
great
person
shirt.
Who's important. I actually love that shirt.
I do too.
I used to wear those frilly shirts, and you know, I used to be able to get away with it. Now, you know, I have a body by McDonald's, so it doesn't work as well anymore.
Steve, I got to share a story with
you. Sure.
Along that same line, I was doing back in the heyday of the Rowdy Cowboy Show. I did it for 10 years at Alligators.
Oh yeah, I remember Alligators.
I met this beautiful young lady to my right, and she was in the ladies' room, and a couple girls were singing the praises of Tomcat. And she's like, yeah, whatever. And she goes, as she left the bathroom, she goes, try doing his laundry for a week.
That is totally, you and my wife, you guys got to go out and have coffee sometime, because that is totally, you know, she would have people hit on her, and she's going to kill me again for this. She used to have people hit on her at the High Noon shows. And if anybody was hitting on me, you know, I told them, hey, see that lady out there? That's my wife. I'd always let everybody know. I'm married. I always had my ring on. I'm a married guy.
And I can attest to that.
Yeah.
Every single show, when they would get in the that little break between songs and he'd be getting ready to amp up a song he was going to sing, he'd always, like, make sure she got a shout out.
Yep.
And I don't remember who was running your spotlight, because they always had a spotlight.
Probably John. John was our spotlight guy at
they
that
put
time.
Put the spotlight right on her, and she'd be like, oh, what's going on?
But she, you know, every time she would get hit on by somebody, she would never tell them that she was that she was married to me. And so she'd tell me, yeah, this guy was hitting on me. And one time Darren Nelson from the Vikings was hitting on her at Vikings Arctic Blast. and like really hitting on her, you know. And I said, well, did you tell them that you're married to me? She's like, no. She goes, if I tell people that I'm married to you, it's like peeing on my territory. I'm like, no, I do it. You know, why don't you do it? So she had, I would never tell anybody, but, you know, she.
Darren Nelson was hitting on your wife.
Darren Nelson. And Darren Nelson, she didn't go home with him.
Is a great old friend of
mine. Darren Nelson is awesome. I loved him, yeah.
And I knew his wife. I mean, I don't know if he's still married. It was like 40 years ago.
Maybe I wasn't supposed to tell that story.
I mean, I met when I used to have a club out in River Falls, Wisconsin. Darren Nelson would come out and do a guest appearance. And I met his little baby at the time, who's now probably 40-some years old.
Yeah, probably, yeah. Well, Darren Nelson was 80s Vikings, man. That was a long time ago. Yeah.
Number 20, right?
I think Mo Williams was number 20. I don't know about Darren.
Well, this is way before
Darren
Mo.
Nelson, though. But yeah, I don't know what number Darren Nelson was anymore.
Danny G.
I'm on it.
All right. She's
I was giving him a ride home, and we were going through Apple Valley. He lived down there, and a cop pulled me over. There's a little speed trap in Apple Valley going east and west. And the cop's like, blah, blah, blah. And he's going to write me out a ticket. And then he goes over and he says, Darren, can I have an autograph? And he looked at him and goes, y'all just gave us a ticket. No.
Number 20.
Yep. Good. You're on it, man.
I'm a huge Vikings fan. Like, I literally bleed purple, so it's one of those
things. Well, we did all the High Noon used to do them Vikings Arctic Blasts all the time. So,
yeah.
You know, we got to meet everybody. I could probably fill a whole episode of Vikings Arctic Blast stories, some good, some bad. But Mo Williams was another guy who actually would remember my name every year. Super, super cool guy, super friendly, used to hang out and talk to us.
Also the recipient of the Randy Moss over the back touchdown.
That was an awesome play.
That was an awesome play.
I told you
that was one of the coolest plays I think I've ever seen.
I know, amazing. Me too. I agree.
Yep. Amazing.
He didn't even look, man.
Yep, he just knew where he was going to be, man.
He had two or three defenders trying to tackle him. He's just like, hey, Mo.
Hey, Mo.
I wonder how many times that's been done.
Well, why don't we give you a second just to put your strings down?
People aren't performing like they it's not come back full bore yet.
Not full bore, but one of the good things is we get done a lot earlier. So it's like, for an old guy like me, it's pretty nice
the
to get to
the 2 a.m. teardown.
As I was mentioning early, lazy musicians.
Yeah, exactly. Well, I do my own setup and teardown, so I'm not sure if I apply.
As a solo guy, for sure.
As a solo guy, yep.
Your High Noon days, you already put yourself out there. Like, I just rolled in. That was the joke with Rowdy Cowboy Show, is that I would just walk in with my microphone box.
It wasn't a joke. That was real.
Yeah, I mean, and I will admit it, for sure. That was, like, my role. I didn't do
setups. But you earned it. You earned it.
I did. Like,
he did all the business and all the back, you know, so he could show up and throw on a mic.
Well, that was the thing, is that most people didn't know. Like, I'm not just showing up to be prima donna. Like, I was running the business outside of that and organizing.
He had a rider, and he said, I have to have my fuzzy koozie.
No brown M&Ms.
You know, I got to backtrack a little bit. You know, I mentioned musicians being lazy a couple times.
You did it.
I don't really believe that, but the reason I say that every once in a while is I don't remember who the group was that didn't want to do an encore. And I looked at their stage manager, and I said, there's 60,000 people out there. Why in the world wouldn't anybody want to do an encore with that huge audience and all the publicity you're getting here? And he looked at me and he goes, well, you have to realize that musicians are inherently lazy.
And that I was looked their at manager.
Him and I laughed and I said, well, that maybe is the only answer I would have accepted. You know?
That is a good comeback.
He stymied there, and I'm like, oh, okay, well, that's why they're not going to do an encore. Still don't sit well with us, but whatever.
Little inside baseball, though, to tell you the truth, with High Noon and our road crew, the road crew made more money than I did.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, you know, that's one of those things that
most
people
don't
know.
We paid them well, and there's a reason for that, because we didn't want to be there till 4 o'clock in the morning. And if you're a vocalist, you know,
you need your rest.
You need to get to sleep early, and... You know, that's I don't know if that's really the reason why Bob wanted to have the road crew. I mean, obviously nobody wants to hump their own gear up and down a ramp into a truck, and we had a pretty good sized truck. You know,
hold on a second now. Stuff, but not only your truck, but you guys had, you should have, well, you saw, TK, the amount of production that you guys had, the lights and the sound and all that stuff was, I mean, it was like jaw dropping.
Yeah, I was super proud of. And no, nobody cared that I was proud because I was just the singer. I didn't own the band. But, I mean, when we went out and played pretty much any show, it was professional. It looked awesome. I used to complain about the fog machine a lot because I don't like the fog machine smell, and I don't like being in a haze all the time. So I had a little issue with that. But realistically, when you have the moving and telebeam lights and things like that, this is pre-LED stuff now with High Noon. Now everything is LED and really cool. But back then we had the programmable IntelliBeams, and Jason Reardon, our light guy, would take a lot of time to program those lights every show. Where, however the stage was, he would move them. You know, he'd change colors. You stand here, make sure I'm hitting you right. A lot of work went into that, and the road crew and our sound guy at the end of High Noon the last few years. Kevin Reed is probably the best sound guy in town.
He's still doing.
He does stuff for Hitchville, and he used to do. I think he did a little bit of stuff for the Farmer's Daughters. He does some stuff for
Maiden Dixie. He was with
a long time. Maiden Dixie too. Yep. So Kevin is again
best in the business.
Best in the business, and the thing I love about Kevin the most is if you ask him a question, and you expect him to sugarcoat it. No, you're going to get the answer that he truly believes in, which I 100% respect.
Yeah.
If somebody will tell you exactly what you need to hear, whether you care or whether you like it or not. You know, caring is another thing, but whether you like it or not, Kevin would tell you how he felt, and I love him for that. I never would hold that against him because it was fantastic to know.
Minor insert, TK, real quick.
Yeah.
It's Kevin's youngest 12th birthday today.
Yep, it is. Yep. Cool. You just post that on Facebook. Lincoln,
yeah.
A little shout out.
Yeah.
You know, I don't think the public realizes how much work goes into a production.
Mm-hmm.
Myself, my wife, we do. If you've got a good sound guy and you've got a good light guy, that enhances your show. So much. I mean, you have got a wonderful voice and you're a talented guitar player. But if you got a good sound guy, they can make you even better.
Yep.
I mean, you know that. I know that. And I don't think the public really realizes, oh, that band was so great, but they're going to be there till 4 o'clock in the morning, 3 o'clock, tearing down this stuff. Yep. Unless you got big money and you can afford
and you're not getting rich doing it.
No.
You know, but it was always
something you love.
It was instilled in me pretty early when I started with my rock band. We had like 8 par cans, and I ran the lights with a foot switch, and we ran sound from the stage.
Oh, wow.
Occasionally, we would have a sound guy, but I told them guys, I was like, you know what? I went on. This was the early days of the internet. Now we're talking really early days of the internet, and there was something I read on there, and it said, yeah, exactly. And there was something on there that said a well lit band is a well paid band.
Yeah.
And High Noon, from the time that I started with them to the time we ended, was one thing about the band. We always had a cool light show. It wasn't always moving and IntelliBeam stuff, but there was always a lot of lights and a follow spot that would follow everybody around when I was out in the audience. And not a lot of bands have that. You know, you get out in the audience, all of a sudden you become the invisible man because everybody's like, hey, where's the singer? Where's that sound coming from? We always could shine on whoever was in the audience, whether it be the fiddle player or myself or Bob, me and the fiddle player on occasion would get out there. So, yeah, it was just looking professional goes a long ways. But,
Danny, can we find some YouTube of High Noon? I'd love to just, if it's possible, find any video there just to kind of let our viewing audience see some example of what you're talking about. Because as you said, both of you now, the highest paid members of any band should be the sound and light guy.
I know there's musicians out there that would say, no, you know, I'm up here doing this. But no, literally, the hardest job is humping all that gear up ramps. It's hot outside. It's raining. It's snowing. You're slipping. The bar, if you play a place like Serums in Anoka and you got an endless amount of stairs to load in into the upper level of Serums, which is where the rock bands played. I mean, it's a load in that everybody knows. In fact, I was just posting on Facebook about it. Somebody was talking about Serums and,
back still hurts.
Oh yeah. Not every club is easy to get access to the stage. So most of them don't have a loading dock that you can just roll your stuff right out. You know, it's hard work. It's super hard. So
after 35 years of working with the stage crew at the Wii Fest, which is one of the largest stages in the world,
yep,
I made it a point every night, ladies and gentlemen, how about a round of applause for the hardest working people in show business? And inevitably, one of the guys would stop, and because no one ever talks about him,
mm-hmm,
and he'd look over and he'd go, they'd give a wave to the audience, and they give him a big hand.
My solo acoustic show is now that I do. I have John Van Bruggen, who used to run monitors for High Noon, and he didn't really have to do a lot, but he's my sound guy for my solo acoustic shows. So I always bring a sound guy, so I can, even if I suck, I'm going to sound good, you know, because I have a sound guy pushing the
button. You miss a note, it's going to sound wrong.
I always introduce. I love Johnny V. He's a great guy. He comes up and plays bass with me once in a while, but I always make sure that I let the audience know he's the second part of the band. He's right, the invisible member, but he is the reason why I sound like I do. Give him a round of applause. Right. And
good,
you know,
for you.
And he gets paid not very handsomely, I would say, but
cheeseburgers and beer.
Well, he normally gets paid out of the tip jar.
Here so. We go. Uh-oh. We got some sound for this. Steve with the iconic hat. All right, she's going to come back to it. So yeah. Tom and I try to make a point, just so you know, Steve, when we have these shows, to make sure that we're promote. We'll go to the video.
And this is at the Wicked Moose in Rochester in 2010. Shot by my lovely bride Gentry, by the way.
I think we're a little hot.
It has a little bit of a distortion to it.
So. I want to challenge Danny.
You find maybe do a little more searching, Danny. See if you can find something that's got more of the light production.
Danny, what I was going to ask you to do is find the original High Noon on Star Search.
There's Bob
singing their big hit.
It's on there. It's on the High Noon Facebook page.
Let's go to that quick.
Oh, I'd love to see that.
So what I was going to say when Danny and I were missing each other in the video insert there is just that we make a point to always talk about the team that we have, because Tom and I are quote-unquote the talent because we're the hosts and we're the ones that are on the video. But without Jill and without Danny and without Kyle and the people that we've had helping
and
with
Lenny.
This, and Lenny, our location manager.
I don't know if you'd refer to me as talent anymore.
Without them, this, you know, the whole thing together doesn't happen. You know,
right.
So it's like they're, especially Danny. I mean, I tell her all the time, and we talk a few times throughout the week about the podcast and what's happening with production and what's happening with content and all that stuff. And I'm always saying, look, you have total creative control over this. I may be writing the checks, but I trust you enough to just let you run. You're that important to what we're doing here. And
I just kind of show up and do what I'm told. Danny likes to boss me around a little bit. Jill hasn't gotten that far.
Yep, there it is.
Is this it? No way.
Can we watch this all?
This isn't actually You Got Away With My Heart. This is a different song. But...
Here's Rick. That's a great song. Darren. Here it is.
Mike Peterson off the drums.
Loving you, I'm not sorry, 'cause it was good. Yes, it hurts now, and my work nights bring you back. You're finally cool.
Who's on the fiddle there?
That's Bruce Hoffman, no relation to Nick Hoffman.
Okay. They look a little alike, though.
He actually helped Nick get his start in Branson, Missouri.
Did he? I don't remember his name.
Okay, Danny.
That brings back so many memories. When my wife and I got married, they played at our wedding reception. That band right there.
And Mike Peterson, the drummer, had a band for a little while. I can't remember what it was. It was like Cowboy Billy or something like that for a little while. But Mike Peterson has an unbelievable country voice. He could do My Maria. And you'd swear you were listening to, is it Ronnie Dunn, I think, that
Ronnie
sings
Dunn,
that?
Yeah.
I mean, you'd swear you're listening to him. He had a fantastic, and Rick Aronson, too.
Yeah.
Great, everybody in that band, and that's kind of the legacy that we took on when in our iteration of High Noon, was to keep that harmony. You know, they always did the big harmonies, so we always kind of like to mold ourselves after, like, Restless Heart, Shenandoah, the bands that actually did a lot of harmonies like that, so that we had actually six people on stage could sing, not all the time, but we did have six vocalists on stage.
That was fun to see that. I'm telling you, those guys were so talented. I don't know how many times in the 80s we had them at the Wee Fest. Half a dozen anyway.
And they were such a big ballroom band back then, too.
Yeah.
If I can just take a second here, gentlemen, to talk directly to the camera. For all those bands out there, take a note. The two things you're missing the boat on are production and harmony. You have to have those two things down tight to make it to the levels of a High Noon or a Killer Hayseeds or some of these other bands that you mentioned. You can't get there without it. I see so many local bands that I go out to, and a lot of them are friends of mine, and they've got a one-and-a-half-part harmony. And it's
not
like
anymore.
You have to have the, you know, even coming out and seeing TFD at the band shell in Oakdale and listening to you and Joe and Linz all sing together is like, that's what you need.
Yeah, the harmonies with the Farmer's Daughters were super, super cool. And when we locked in together, you know, we did that song Girl Crush.
Yeah.
Which was always my favorite part of the night because I got to put my guitar down. I got to stand up there with the two girls and actually be part because it was their show.
It's about a girl that likes girls, just so you know.
not really, but it's a super cool song. But it's a Little Big Town. Is it Little Big Town? Who's the name of that band? Yeah. So I don't know my country bands very well, but I apologize.
He's nailing it all night. I don't know him very well.
but that song is so good for harmonies.
Which song is it?
Girl Crush. I think we have one of them. I think we have a little bit of that on Facebook, too. But
TFD?
It might be on my Facebook page, actually. I think I posted it a couple of weeks ago. But, I mean, it's when we lock in on that harmony, literally, I mean, all the hair, well, I don't have a lot. I shouldn't even say hair because I got no hair, but the hair on my arms just, I mean, it just stands up. It's unbelievable.
What a great song that is.
I got
is.
A chance to sing with the girls, and it was truly fun. I really loved it.
Danny, are you looking for it?
Maybe someday you can bring the girls in and y'all can sing that.
Oh, that's Bob right there.
Yeah, that's the video for one of the songs I wrote back when I was a kid.
But you can see more of the production, like the
yeah,
big
there's some lights
and
stuff.
And there's Nick.
Some fog. Yeah. And
that's Nick Hoffman.
Yep.
Yeah, and this was shot in 1999 at Blainbrook.
Oh.
And it was done by a man named Tony Evans. He's a photographer. He was the band photographer for many years. Yeah, coming up here, it shows us live at Blainbrook, and you can see the lights and production in the background.
A lot of talent has come out of that band.
And it actually shows me with hair. Wait for the mullet.
That's Steve in the back with the hat on, believe it or not, with the mullet.
Is Nick in that picture?
Yes,
he was, front left.
Okay, I saw him. He looked like a little kid.
Yeah, he did. He was 17 or 18 in this one.
This feels so 90s.
Oh,
Yeah, great.
Yeah, and a little shout out to the drummer on that video, Troy Niebergall, was a fantastic drummer, and he just died 2 years ago. I think it was 2 years ago now.
Too young.
Of cancer.
I don't know how old he was, but it had to be too young.
He was just a little bit older than me, so he was in his early 50s.
The drummer in the most recent version of High Noon, what was his name again?
That is Mark Solberg.
And we lost his wife to cancer,
yes,
right?
Yes, Mary.
Yeah, because I was at the benefit that they did at Two Stooges for that.
Yep. Yeah, and Mary was super, super nice. Marky just got remarried, but Marky is one of my favorite people in the world. Super good guy. Again, like you said, salt of the earth. Just a great human being. So, and recently has found God in a big way. So he was not there until about 2 years ago, and situations happened that he found God, and he is very, very devout now. So.
I hate to look a gift horse in the mouth here, TK, but that's kind of a segue, right?
It is a segue. Tell us a little bit, Steve, about the church that you're performing at now on a regular basis, which is something that I totally admire.
Well, I always thought after I retired from High Noon, after we retired the band, that the only thing that would ever pull me out of retirement, because I sold everything. I had no guitars. I had no musical equipment whatsoever at the house. I just quit because I'd played so long, I'd done so much stuff, I'd traveled so much, I was like, enough.
You know, Clean break.
I just needed to focus on the kids and my marriage and work and just doing other stuff other than plan. And a guy that used to be my boss when I was 19 at Target in Crystal, Minnesota, called me up one day and he goes, you know, I'm playing at Cambridge Lutheran Church as the keyboard player. Bill's a very good keyboard player. And he goes, we need somebody there that has done some big shows. You know, we got vocalists here now, but we need to add a little more. And I want you to come up and play once in a while. And I was like, Bill, I've got literally no equipment. I'll bring
my spoons.
and he goes, well, you know, that's too bad. You know, we could really use you. He said, are you sure? And I'm like, well, I said, I think I'd like to. I said, you know, I have the money to get the equipment that I need. I want to at least be able to play there a couple of times a month. And he said, well, I don't know if we can do that or not. And I said, well, I'll tell you what, I'm going to make the investment anyway, because it's a good cause. It's church. It's the only thing that I thought I would ever do after High Noon. And I'm like, so I'm going to do it. So I've been playing there since November of 2017. Yeah, that's us at Cambridge Lutheran. Super, super good band. We got Bill's on the keyboard there, Bill Carson. That's Sheena Ray. She lives here in North Branch. Former member of Steel Orchid, who has the guitar player that I used to play with in my rock band. Adam Lane back there behind the drums. And then off to the side next to Sheena, you can't see him, as Steve Danz plays in the band as well. But super, super good band, super fun band, high energy.
Who's the ball guy and the lead there?
Yeah. And, you know, basically what I did is I just took, you know, I do what I do. When you know, I'm kind of laid back otherwise, but if you put a guitar in my hand and you put me on a stage, I have energy, and I brought that to the church, whether they liked it or not, but apparently they did. I've been there for a while, but it's super, super fun. I get to sing. For a couple of years, I did a song called I Just Want to Be a Sheep for Little Kids for the Easter performance. So I get the little kids to do their thing, and they go ba 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 behind me, and it's super cool. I'm a simple guy. I love that stuff. I sing at my wife's nursing home that she works at, Elam in Princeton, once in a while. That's also a religious organization, so I sing in the chapel, but I do just regular songs. But, you know, I'm a simple guy. I like to do that kind of stuff for people, and then, you know, now I do the other stuff on the side. So, but the church thing has been super rewarding. I admittedly was not, I never went to church my entire life. Was I a believer? Yeah. But did I go to church? No, I wasn't. I wasn't a person that wanted to be there. Pastor Andy Romstad at the church is phenomenal. And, you know, like I said, we got a decent band there. The songs that we pick are good. If you get a chance to come out to see Cambridge Lutheran Church, it's really, they've upgraded their facility.
That's not far from our house right here.
Yeah, it's right down 95 from you. So
yeah, we get into Cambridge quite a bit, and Lynn and I like, we go to Eaglebrook. Yep. She and I both are Catholics, but we go to Eaglebrook most of the time, every once in a while.
Speaking of good bands, yeah, Eaglebrook's got a good thing going there. So,
and I'd love to come and see you perform someday, some Sunday.
I was just going to say, is there a specific service that you play?
I play at the Horizon side, so it's the contemporary worship. Through the summer until Labor Day, we are doing one outdoor service every week, and it starts at 10 o'clock. Then after Labor Day, we go back inside and we do, I believe it's a 9 o'clock service and then a 10:30 service after.
We'll come
that.
And see you for sure.
So I'd love to see you there.
Isn't it great when you get to a point in your life, you know, you did all the big shows and, you know, the notoriety and the fun stuff. And then when you really get down to it, giving back is really what it's all about. And that's the most rewarding thing.
Well, I hope
not getting the accolades, it's doing whatever you can do for your church or whatever they've got going on in that church.
I hope when people leave that we've brought them closer to God in some way.
You bet.
And they enjoy the music. And if that's what brings them in to God, then I'm more than happy to do it. Yeah.
You bet. What do you think, pal?
I think it's great. I mean, I'm just like, I'm blown away at just thinking about the prominence of your, not just your life, but your musical career and this evolution that you've gone through. And
you're killing me.
You're such a humble dude, Steve. Seriously. I mean,
ever since
the moment I met you, just a humble guy. And to get where you are now and to see you having so much joy in your life from music and not just the success of High Noon and the stages you play, but the joy that you get from playing for Christ, for playing for God, that's amazing to me.
It's a very good thing. Yeah.
I don't know what to add to that. I mean, our podcast is not a Christian podcast, but we talk about God enough in it. We close with a little statement about the Lord, and I could talk about it all night long. And
inside baseball, I'd like to tell everybody that we do have a little prayer circle before the show here, which was super awesome, and I wasn't expecting it, so. These guys are real believers here. So
you're the first one to mention it.
Yeah. Before every podcast, we huddle up and thank the Lord and ask for his help. And
ask for extra help.
Yeah.
As much as we can get.
Yeah. You don't really need it because you're just really on all the time.
Oh, come on.
Trying to keep Bernie awake, right?
Hey, you're sleeping over here?
All those nice things that I said.
You can't tell.
I had to. He called me Kenny Chesney.
From one Christian to another, kiss my ass.
I love it.
I found that Girl Crush video if you want to.
Please, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
What did you find?
The Girl Crush video
with
the harmonies.
Don't look.
don't look yet.
Don't look. Okay.
Okay.
You can look now.
And I'd like to send out a shout to Lindsay, who's a phenomenal vocalist.
Amazing vocalist.
I can sure hear the crowd singing. Wow.
There's Lady Jo, TK.
Yeah. Yeah.
Amazing. I mean, I got the goosebumps when you came in. It was the three of you together.
And Lady Jo, just the icing on the cake, totally. It, like I said, when we would come in on that and we lock in like that, and I got it right on top of my ears, so it's like nookie for my eardrums with my in-ears when we lock in like that. I'm like, oh, this is so cool. So I'm actually glad we got a video of that.
So. I said, do you and Jo like trade typical, stereotypical roles? Because you know, she typically will take an octave a little lower, and you like to be up on that top end a little.
You know, that's where I feel comfortable singing that higher harmony. But in that band, because you got two females and they take that note above, then I was starting to take the one below. But there were certain instances, like if we did Dixie Chicks that Earl had to die tune. You know, I would do the high when on the na-na-nas. I was taking the high part, and Jolene was taking the one lower. So, okay. Yeah, that was where the vice grips came in handy again. So.
Well, Steve, before we let you get out of here, tell everybody where they can find you.
Yeah.
You know, I'm going to be playing at the Mississippi Pub on the 5th of August. That's a 6 to 9 show. I do have another, that's a solo acoustic gig, and then I'm going to be playing again on August 22nd, at Max Bar, and I believe that show is from 1 o'clock to 4 o'clock. I do have a Facebook page for my solo acoustic shows. It's Steve Kretsinger Solo Acoustic Extravaganza. So if you can type that in, you can find me, you can find out where I'm playing. I always update about a week ahead of time. And I am doing some Caged Bird stuff coming up very soon. Yep, there it is. So
kind of like A to Z Trucking right in the phone book there.
Yep.
I'll say there's that fog machine he likes so much.
Yep, there's the fogger in the background of the picture. Yeah, I actually kind of like that picture. But
And then we'll hold on a second, Danny. Go back down a little bit. Stop right there. What's the first related page? I'm having a hard time reading that.
What's that?
On the left, related pages.
Oh yeah, there it is. My wife's page. I didn't notice that was there.
A little shout out to her right before we get out the door. Well, folks, I tell you what. We hope you enjoyed this week's episode of Boots and Backstraps. I know we've enjoyed having you here for this one, Steve.
Thank you for having me. This was really, really cool.
It was great. Your voice and the songs that you did, totally loved it. I hope our audience loved it as much as we did.
Yeah, for
you
wanna, sure.
I want to show you something real quick that I think is like the coolest endorsement for Steve, right?
Yeah.
That's his daughter says, I guess my dad is kind of cool.
She's getting her pick on her head.
That's Alana, my daughter. So.
Isn't that's
sweet?
A 21-year-old?
Yep.
And she likes you. That's a big deal for a 21-year-old.
You know,
like
she's
dad,
she's
you know?
Like a mini-me and with cars, with
hair.
Mustangs. And yeah, she's...
Do you see this right here, TK? Do you see where the little blue thumbs up and the red heart is? She's got 55 interactions on that post. That's awesome.
Oh, yeah.
That's great.
It is great.
Her dad's kind of a big deal.
He's
a good dude and a big deal. Well, folks, do us a favor and pinwheel, as we like to say in the hunting community, pinwheel that like button. Make sure you give us a share and a comment and tell all of your friends about the Boots and Backstraps podcast. If you have questions, comments, or snide remarks, you can send those to bootsandbackstrapspodcast@gmail.com. And we're looking forward to getting another fancy guest in here like Steve. TK.
Man, I tell you, you know, I want to do a shout out to John Basinger out in Craig, Colorado.
Yes, sir.
He's an elk hunting guide while he guides mule deer, antelope, elk. Just a great guy. A great conversation with him today, and he wanted me to say hello to you and
wonderful.
All of our friends out there in Colorado. We're going to be seeing you at least once this fall. And
another salt of the earth guy.
Absolutely. We are so fortunate to know so many great people. And I mean, I think that's how it works when you really devote your life to the Lord, and He'll put good people in your life, and He works through people, and that's what we need. So, ladies and gentlemen, thanks for joining us today, and whether you're belting out your favorite country song or you're pursuing your favorite game animal, I encourage you to use that same passion to pursue the Lord. He'll teach you to shoot straight. Thanks again. We'll see you next week.
The hunt is on, looking for backstraps, way deep in the woods, tracking in a swamp to a hay field under the harvest moon. When the tags are filled, it's time to switch up our boots. Head down to the honky tonk, get us a swing dance or two. We're talking about boots and backstraps.